Hello everybody, welcome to the session four of week one in marketing analytics course. This is Dr. Sagar Chatterjee from VGSOM IIT Kharagpur, who will be taking this course for you. So till the last video, we have actually created data set and we have saved and again read a data set from the computer. In this particular session, we will actually play with the data set a little bit. So, if you open session week 1 S4 W1S4.R, so week 1 session 4.R file, it looks like this. Again, as usual, we will actually clean our console, clean our environment, and so you can click on this brass sign to clean the environment here and Control L to clean the console, and then you can also remove all other files that is open in R. Only W1S4.R this file should be open. If you are at that stage, then we can start. So, I will ask you to check line number 3 to 6. So, quickly if you just run all these 6 lines, I will not tell you what is happening because we have already discussed about them. So, can you just spend 1 minute on your time, pause this particular video, spend 1 minute of your time and see that what has happened. So, what has happened is actually that I have created 4 variables, and the company variable is a character variable. If you see line number 4, I have created a company variable which has 3 PNG, then 3 HUL and then 3 Marico, and I have also created a FY which is financial year, which is 99, 2000, 2001 repeated 3 times, and then I have certain revenue values, certain margin values, each of them has a size of 9. So, when I put all of this thing in a data frame in line number 7, the data frame looks like this, that there are 99, 2000, 2001 repeats 3 times. For each company, there are 3 financial year corresponding revenues and margins are given, something like that I create. Now, I will play with this data set a little bit. So, there are lots of ways you can do many things. For example, the first thing that I want to do is probably calculate the actual profit. I have been given the revenue and I have given the margin and I want to calculate the actual profit. So, to do that, what I will do is, so data dollar and let us say profit. So, data dollar profit is not there right now, and I am introducing data dollar profit as a new variable in this particular data set. And I am saying data dollar profit is equal to what? It is how it can be created. It is actually revenue into margin by 100. That is all. So, data dollar revenue into data dollar margin divided by 100. So, if I just run this line, you will see in this particular thing there is a profit column that comes up. So, data dollar profit, this particular column this comes up. So, I can actually create new columns like this, and later point of time I will show you very various other things that I can do. Now, one very obvious things, very common thing that we try to do is to find out, let us say in this data set, how can I find out the for every let us say every company, what is the highest margin and what is the lowest margin out of these 3 things. So, oftentimes we do many things. If we do like company wise average of sales, company wise growth rate of sales and this and that. So, we break the data set in each company wise or sometimes each financial year wise and try to create something like that. So, for that there is a library called DPLYR. Now, what is a library? A library is something that has been written by various users, which has been validated by other users and then stored in something called a repository of C, called CRAN, where most of the libraries, most of the common libraries are saved, and we actually call those libraries. So, library is actually nothing but a set of functions kept together. Now, this function should be of related topic, like for example, there is some library which is related to all form of time series analysis. So, all the functions which are related to time series analysis that has been written by the write out of that particular library is stored together. Similarly, here there is a library called dplyr, and now oftentimes you will not know the library name. You might also again go to, so you have to go and search in Google that what you want to do, and based on that you will find out the library and the code. So these codes are not written by me, I have taken from somewhere, change it as per my need and then kept it here. So that is what you have to also do. So here in my next job, what I will do is I will actually find out for each company what is the highest margin and what is the lowest margin for. So if this is my data set, so let us say the company PNG, the highest margin of PNG is 13, the lowest margin is 11. For HUL, the highest margin is 13, the lowest is 12. For Marico, the highest is 14, the lowest is 9. So company wise, I will find this out and save it in a data set. You can also do something else and I will tell you what to do. So to do that, the first thing that I will do is this library dplyr, I have to call that. Now if it is not, so here is a packages tab here, and it's actually lists out all the libraries that are already there in your computer. Now if by chance dplyr is not there, or if by running this you get an error error message, then it will mean that the dplyr package is not installed, it is not installed in your computer. So then you have to install, you have to have a HTTPS enabled computer secure internet connection. So for that, what you will to do is you can click on this install button and a pop-up will come, and here you have to write dplyr. So you can choose dplyr, the repository is CRAN as I told, and you have to click install, and the installation is by default in your, in the same folder where your R has been installed. You can also write install packages, install packages, and within that with quote dplyr. And sometimes if you want to install multiple these things, multiple libraries together, you can actually write dplyr comma something else comma something else and so on. So here we will try to install dplyr. If you press an enter right now, I will not press because for me it is already installed. But if you want to press an enter right now, you will see here a red button will come up, and then you will see that lots of downloads are happening continuously, 3-4 downloads or probably more, probably 15-20 downloads will happening. Well, there will be small files, 1 MB, 2 MB depending on the speed of your internet, it will be pretty faster, and I hope that you will be seeing this particular video in 4G connection kind of stuff, so then it will be pretty fast. And lots of files will get installed. When we install dplyr, generally one library is dependent on other libraries. So when people write their codes, they actually say that okay, this library will only run when other certain dependencies are also installed. So all those dependencies will also get installed and downloaded if by chance they are not already there in your computer. So all of them gets downloaded, and if you do not get an error message, you are good in place. So if you by chance get error message, there are lots of different kinds of error that can happen, and depending on what kind of error message is coming, you can post the error message in the forum and we will try to solve that. So once that is installed, you have to call the library. So I will just run this one, and I have called the library. Library dplyr has been called. That means all the functions which are in dplyr can be used right now, they are in a usable form. Now this is a syntax which is a little bit difficult, and I would want you to focus on the syntax carefully. So line number 13, it is saying that my results is equal to, so something I do and then save it in my results. So my results is equal to data, that means this data. So data and then a sign, which is basically percentage greater than percentage. That means it's a piping sign. It says that data and then group by company. So within data there is a company column. So for which is a categorical variable. So whatever you write here has to be categorical. So group by company, and then you mutate. There is two options, one is mutate, the next one another is summarize, and I will tell you what these things are. Mutate, highest margin is equal to max of margin, whatever is the margin, find out the maximum of that, put it in highest margin, and whatever is margin, find out the minimum of that and put it in lowest margin. So, what it does is something like this. So what it does is something like this. So, it will, let us say this is my data set, which is FY company, and then there is margin. So, and some other things are also there, and company A is there, and company B is there, and it is coming 12, 13, 9, let us say, and 13, 15, 17, let us say. So, the first thing this guy does here is that group by company. That means it will group the data set based on company. So, this is one part, this is one part, it is grouping. Oftentimes your data set will not have all the A's sequentially, all the B's sequentially. It can be A, B, A, B, A, B, and so on. So, it will group it, all the A's together, all the B's together, irrespective of how A's and B's are written, whether A's are written in one group or A and B are haphazard, does not matter. Now, it will find out that what is the maximum of this margin. The maximum of this margin is 13 and maximum of this thing is 17. So, when I write that mutate, it will change the original data set. So, this was the original data set. It will write, okay, highest margin, I think if I have no, I am not wrong, this was highest margin is equal to maximum of margin. So, it will write highest margin, and the value corresponding to that will be the maximum of margin. So, it will, the maximum margin is 13. So, for all of them it will write 13. The maximum of margin is 17 here, for all of them it will write 17. Similarly, for the lowest margin it will write 999, and in this case 13, 13, 13. So, mutate actually changes the original data set. Now, if I write instead of mutate, if I write something else, so let us say if I write summarize, in the next line what I have written is highest profit margin is equal to data, group it by company, and write summarize. So, summarize what will do? It will, in this particular case, what it will do is, let us say I again had FY and then company and then the margin, and it was AAA and then BBB and some values, let us say 9, 13, 15 and 7, 6, 12, something like that, the values were there. The moment I summarize, what it will do is, it will group it first as usual, and when I summarize, it will create a new data set, which will be a summary version of this data set, where there will be company, and company will be A and B, that is all, and there will be a margin, I think best margin or something like that, if I am not wrong, just I will check. The variable is best margin, so it will create another variable called best margin, and that value will be, in this case it will be 15, in the second case it will be 12. So, it is a new data set that gets created. So, all I am trying to say here is that you can try out the mutate and these two things, and you will be, so one is mutate, one is summarize, and you will know what this is. So, I will run this line, my results is gets created, and my results you will see that highest margin is coming up, which is 13, 13, 13, 13, 13, 13 for PNG, because PNG's highest is 13, HUL's highest is also 13, so again another 3 13s. And then this guy's highest is 14, so another 3 14s. And then this is for lowest margin. And if I do a summarize, I get this particular thing, which is a summary version of the data. So, somehow we can use DPLYR to summarize this data. I will ask you, or I will actually run you through, if let us say I want to find out from the same data set, what is the, let us say what is the highest revenue minus profit, so highest costs. So, what in which particular this thing, in which particular, what is the highest cost for PNG out of these three? or let us say irrespective of PNG, forget about PNG, for FY, for various FY, what is the highest cost of FY 2009, 1999, 2000 and 2001. So, what I do is first things first, I will just create a in my data set data dollar cost, which is a new variable I am creating, is data dollar revenue minus data dollar profit, that is the cost, fair enough. And then my, let us say, new data, which is a trial version, is data and then this sign, and then I have to group by FY. I have to group by FY because for each financial year I want to know what is the highest this thing. So, and then I want to summarize. Summarize means I will create a new variable, summarize highest this thing is, let us say, highest cost or lowest cost. I want to know the lowest cost. So, lowest cost is equal to minimum of cost, minimum of cost and C capital or small, C, this is case sensitive. So, if I run this, there is an error comes. So, okay, so group by, I think group by FY, that has to be factor. New data is equal to data this summarize minimum of cost. Cost is there, C is small. So, I will just once more, I will just probably copy here, copy from here and paste it here. So, new data, let us say new data is equal to data group by as factor FY, and let us say lowest cost is minimum of cost. Yeah, so it worked. So, new data is equal to this. So, lowest, so it has to be lowest cost. I typed it wrong, lowest cost I typed. So, whatever be the case, now here what I am getting is as factor 1999, 2000 and 2001. So, these are the three guys. So, what did it happen? So, it, see, I told that not always the A's and B's will be in order. So, here 1999, another 1999 is at this place and another 1999 is this place. So, these are the three 1999's, called row number 1, row number 4, row number 7, they joined it together, grouped it together. And the cost is lowest for, here it is 9000, around 10000, here it is 12000, close to 12000, and here it is 8789, the lowest is 8789. So, it has given 118789. Similarly, for 2000, here it is row number 2 and then row number 5 and then row number 8, and the corresponding value is 12000. Again 12000 and here 10000, so the corresponding value is 10000. So, that is how you can summarize a data set. So, we will do a little bit more, we will learn something called a if else function. So, if else is something like what you do in Excel. So, it is a if function. How does you write in if function in Excel? You write it like this way, you write is equal to if, and then there are three syntaxes basically. So, one is the check, what you want to check, the logic. If the logic is true, the result when true, and this is the result when false. That is how the if function is written in Excel if you have tried it. Similar things we will do it here. The only thing that becomes is, it becomes if else. So, I will write it in this way, if else function. So, let us say I want to say in this data tab, if the margin is higher than 10, I will say that high margin, it is high margin. So, I will create a new column which is called margin high low, And if the value of margin is higher than 10, I will say high. If the margin is lower than 10, I will say low. So, wow, I will write that. So, I am saying data dollar margin high low, that means it is a new variable called margin high low, which is equal to if else, and then if else there are three syntaxes as I told. So, I will just put two commas, so that it becomes easier to write. Two commas I have written. The first thing before the comma is the syntax that will check whether the margin is higher than 10 or not. So, my syntax is data dollar margin, whether this guy is higher than 10 or not. The second syntax is what? The second syntax is basically the high. So, this is high. And the third syntax is what? When it is not greater than 10, then what result will come? So, I am saying it is low. See, high and low I have written in quotes because these are text. So, data dollar margin high low, I am creating a new variable in my data set, is equal to if else is the function, it has three syntax. First is the check, second is the value that comes when the check is right, and the third is the when the value is false. So, if I just run this one, I have created another column in data set. See, there are highs and some lows. So, this guy is coming low because this is the only guy who is where margin is 9, which is less than 10. You can also have multiple these things. So, let us say if it is greater than smaller than 10, or let us say greater than 15, I will say very high, but 10 to 15 I will say high and otherwise low. So, you can do all this ifs and buts, and it, whether it is greater than and lower than, you can have multiple things, you can join them through and or and etcetera, what we did in the previous videos, that you can do it here as well. Now, I will try to teach another thing which is called a loop. This is an important thing. Loop means that it same things gets repeated continuously. So, let us say I am trying to do it some in this way, that I will start from the first row, end at the last row, and from the first row and the, I will start from the first row, end at the last row, and I will say that every this thing, how much jump has happened. So, how much was the revenue growth that has happened? So, revenue growth for PNG is, let us say, from this to this. So, I will do it fast for only PNG, let us make it simple. So, from this to this, how much growth has happened in percentage term, and from this to this, how much growth has happened from percentage term. So, to do that, for only PNG, not anybody else, the first thing that I will do is I will create a data set, which is a subset of the data which has only PNG. So, data dollar company double is equal to PNG. So, those who have a little bit of knowledge about coding before, you will know that for check of equality, for check, if you do not want to assign something, but if you want to check of equality, they you have to give double equal to instead. So, for greater than, smaller than is checks whether it is higher and lower, double equal to checks whether it is absolutely same or not. Now, check what I have written here. I have written that I am subsetting this data set called data. The name of the data set is data. So, I am subsetting it. I have written nothing after the comma. That means all the column I am taking. But I have written something before the comma. What did I write? I wrote only this part. If I just copy this part and paste it here, I am getting first three values as true and the rest of the values as false, because the first three guys are for PNG and the next six guys are false because they are not of PNG. Now, if I put here and subset it based on this, then the first three rows will be taken and all other rows will be left aside, and all the columns will be taken because nothing is written after the comma. So, if I run this, I get a data set which has only PNG. Fair enough. Now, I will create another column which is a growth rate, and I will say that growth rate is nothing but the previous versus now divided by the previous. So, I will write it this way. So, let us say I am writing data 1 dollar growth rate GR is equal to NA. So, I am introducing or is equal to 0, let us say. I am introducing something which is currently 0 and then I will replace this. Now, I am writing a loop. Now, remember this loop will start from 2, go up to 3. So, I am writing for I in 2, 2, 3, just carefully see what I am writing. For I in 2, 2, 3, so I is an index which starts at 2, ends at 3. And then I write a bracket. So, you do not write it right now. When you try to practice it by writing, after I have written everything, you just try to replicate that. So, for I in 2, 2, 3, what happens? I will first find out. So, when the loop starts, I's value is 2. So, I's value is 2 means then data dollar, let us say if I write revenue I, that is what I's value is 2. So, data dollar revenue is data, sorry, not data dollar revenue, data $1 revenue. So, data $1 revenue is what? Data $1 revenue is this particular column. And here I is equal to 2, that means second entry. So, this is what I am written. So, data dollar revenue 2 minus data $1 revenue I minus 1, that means data $1 revenue within third bracket 1, which is that this one. So, I have just written this minus this. Okay, so, that is the growth. Now, I have to find out the growth rate. So, divided by the previous. So, this was the previous, fair enough. So, current value minus the previous value divided by the previous value, that is the growth rate. So, how much is the growth rate? Where will it be saved? This will get saved in this value whatever written data $1 GR I. That means, when I is equal to 2, 2 minus 1 by 1 will get saved in 2. And when I is equal to 3, 3 minus 2 by 2 will get saved into 3, the third entry. So, for this one, 1, 4 minus 6, 7 by 1, 1, 2, 3, 4 divided by 1, 1, 2, 3, 4 will saved here. And then next, 1, 5, 6, 9, 8 by 1, 4, 5, 6, 7 divided by 1, 4, 5, 6, 7 will get saved here. So, this is how I am calculating a loop. Now, to run this loop, what do I have to do? I have to select the whole thing. You can see that there is a small drop down button coming up at 27. So, it is saying the loop starts and loop ends. If you click on that, 27 to 29 gets collapsed. If you again click on that, it comes up. So, all you have to do is whatever gets collapsed together, you have to run the whole thing together. So, I am selecting the whole thing together and I am running it and it has run. And if I now want to see data 1, you see that the percentage changes or probably the point values are given. So, the first jump was 29%, 29.66%, the second jump was 7.7%. You can try to run a loop on your own. At a later point of time, we will try to see what loop is. And the last part of this particular thing is called a function. So, we have used lots of functions which has been already pre-built, but we have to write a function. If I write a function like this, the function is something like this, where there will be certain inputs, it can be more than one inputs, and there will be certain outputs, again more than one outputs, and there will be certain job that is done by this particular function. So, that is how a function works. There will be some input, and there will be some output, and there will be certain jobs here. So, now the job that you define is irrespective of, so you have to say that, so function, if you remember, we write it f of x is a function. So, x is the input and f of x is the job that it does and gives something as an output which is y. So that is how we will also write a function. Now, x can be more than one items. For example, let us say if I ask you, that do one thing, write a function where it will take any column as its input and it will do one thing easily. It will find out let us say the z value of the column. So, those who have done statistics, I hope that you have an idea, or it will give the normalized version of the column. This is very, very common that we do. So, what is normalized thing? The normalizing thing is that if I have a old z, or if I have x, the normalized form of x is nothing but x is a variable. Let us say x has lots of values from 1, 2, 5, 7, 9, 11, 15, whatever, and I want to compress those values between 0 and 1 in a linear order. I will interpolate them between 0 and 1. So, what I write is x is equal to x minus minimum of x by maximum of x minus minimum of x, something like this. So, this is something that we try to write, and this is a function that I will write which will take any x and give this as an output. So, what will I write? I have to first say that, let us say normalize, I do not know, is equal to any name, you can give any other name, does not matter, is equal to a function of x. This is a, it is a fx. Remember, in mathematics we write it like this way. So, y is equal to fx such that it is 5 when x is greater than 2, is it e to the power x when x is less than 2 or something like that. So, this is how we write. So, first we write a y is equal to f a function of x. So, similarly, if y is a function of multiple values, then I have to write y is a function of, so if y is a function of multiple values, then I have to write y is function of x comma z, let us say. So, the moment I write 2, I know that there are 2 inputs that I have to give. If I write only f x, I know that I have to give only 1 input. Similarly, here depending on how many inputs you want to give, you have to write x or x comma y or x comma whatever, x 1 comma x 2 comma x 3 and etcetera. So, here I want only 1 input. So, normalize is equal to function of x, and then what do I want? I want x minus minimum of x divided by max of x minus minimum of x. This is what I want. And I want to save it, let us say, in some name ABCD, ABCD is equal to this. And it is good practice when you write a function that, because oftentimes there can be situations where you have to write multiple lines of codes within function. It is not straightforward one liner. You have to do this, then that, lots of things. And then you get some value and you want to return that value. So, it is very important to say that what do you want to return? So, I want to return within bracket ABCD. See, here also, like for loop, there is a drop down thing has come up. So, it is the whole thing that is coming up. So, I will choose the whole stuff and run this. The moment I run this, you will see here there is a function called normalize get saved. Now, this is a function which name is normalized. I have saved this function, but I have not used this function till now. Now, if I want to use it, let us say there is data dollar profit, this is a profit and I want to normalize it between 0 and 1. So, I will write normalize and within bracket data dollar profit. So, take this particular value and normalize them, and this is the output. See, all the values are between 0 and 1. The lowest value is 0, the highest value is 1, and other values are between 0 and 1. And it is also important that I have only printed, I have not saved it somewhere. So, if you want to save it in the data set, you have to write data dollar norm prof, let us say normalized profit is nothing but this thing. So, then it gets saved in your data set. So, in the data set you get a norm prof where it is 0 and 1. So, all I have done here in this particular video is to create a data set and then using library dplyr to create a summary or mutate of the data set, and then we used if else, loop and function. These are very small, small basic examples, but we will use a little bit of complex versions when we actually do and solve certain problems. Thank you very much for being patient in terms of hearing this particular video, in terms of practicing video. We'll meet you in the next video.